Was first delivered to the RAF in 1938, the Sunderland flying boat began what was to become one of the longest serving careers of any frontline aircraft. It was one of the very few types to remain in operational service throughout the Second World War and the only RAF aircraft to perform frontline duties for the whole of the Korean War. When it finally retired in 1959, it had served for a total of 21 years and had built up a reputation as a tough and reliable workhorse. Several British and overseas commercial airlines operated Sunderlands and their derivatives during the post-war period. These operations came to an end in 1958, and when the RAF's Far East boats retired in May 1959, the days of the Sunderland flying boat were finally over. Today, the sole surviving airworthy example is the ex-RAF boat ML-814. Built as a Mark III, as part of a batch of 25 aircraft, she left the Shorts factory in Belfast and was delivered to 57 Maintenance Unit in March 1944. During the last 2 years of the war, she served with 201 Squadron of the Royal Air Force and 422 Squadron of the Canadian Air Force. In 1945, she was converted to Mark V standard and went to 272 maintenance unit before being transferred to the Royal New Zealand Air Force as NZ4108. When her service career ended, she was bought by the Australian company Ansett Flying Boat Services of Brisbane. Bearing the name Islander, ML814, or VHBRF in civilian registration, stayed with Ansett until 1974. Sold to Antilles Airboats, she was rechristened Excalibur 8 and remained in overseas service for the next 6 years. In May 1981, she was bought by Edward Holton and flown back to England from Bermuda. As a tribute to the Sunderland's chief designer, she was renamed Sir Arthur Gouge and flew under the British civilian registration GBHJS. She spent the rest of the decade at her moorings in Chatham before finally moving in the early 1990s to her present home in the United States. In 1908, the firm of Short Brothers Limited was formed by three of the greatest pioneers in the history of aviation, the brothers Horace, Albert, and Hugh Short. They had already developed a prosperous business making balloons for rich amateur aviators, and now the company became the first manufacturer of commercial aircraft in the world. Within 2 years, the brothers had built their first aeroplane factory and had begun to design their first aeroplane, the short biplane number one. By 1913, their machines had been used to assess the potential of aircraft for naval use, and Winston Churchill had already introduced the word seaplane. As naval contracts began to come to Shorts, seaplane production was carried out by just 12 employees in a new factory at Rochester on the River Medway in Kent. During the First World War, the company built reconnaissance and anti-submarine patrol seaplanes for the Royal Naval Air Service. Small seaplanes, such as the 184 and 320, were soon followed by the first of a line of Short Brothers flying boats, the big twin-engine Felixstowes. This range of wooden biplanes outlived the war, and the F5 Felixstowe remained in first-line service until well into the 20s. The next 10 years saw the company move away from traditional wooden construction to more innovative machines with metal fuselages. One of the early results of this change was the Short Singapore Mark 1 flying boat. In 1927, a Singapore 1 was loaned to the Air Ministry in order to undertake a 23,000-mile survey of Africa on behalf of Imperial Airways. Powered by two 800-horsepower Rolls-Royce engines, driving tractor and pusher propellers, the machine was flown by Sir Alan Cobham. After he completed the survey in 1928, Shorts modified the Mark 1 design to take three engines instead of two. Named the Calcutta, the new machine was ordered by Imperial Airways, and from 1928 onwards, it became one of the earliest boats to be used on British commercial air routes. A military version followed soon after and was given the name Rangoon. When it entered service in 1931, it joined the ranks of the RAF's ever-expanding fleet of large general reconnaissance flying boats. By the mid-1930s, Imperial Airways had won government approval to develop a range of fast and efficient air routes throughout the British Empire. As well as carrying passengers to Africa, India, Australia, and the Far East, the new service would result in vastly improved delivery times for the existing Empire Mail scheme. Imperial Airways decided to use flying boats on each of the main routes. Having already supplied Calcuttas to the airline, Shorts were asked to design a new boat capable of carrying passengers and mail over very large distances. In place of the traditional biplane configuration, chief designer Arthur Gouge opted for a high-wing monoplane design. Plans were drawn up for a four-engine flying boat capable of carrying a 5-ton cargo of passengers and freight. Designated the S-23 and labelled by Imperial Airways as C-class machines, the first two boats, Canopus and Caledonia, made their maiden flights during the summer of 1936. Shortly after the initial orders had been completed, nearly 30 boats were in operation with Imperial Airways, and almost half that number again with the Australian airline Qantas. Running in parallel with the development of the S-23 was the program to find a replacement for the Singapore 3. In 1933, the Air Ministry had issued specification number R-233, calling for a monoplane, four-engined, maritime reconnaissance aircraft, which would eventually supersede the biplane Singapore. Shorts tendered the S-25, a design very similar in size and appearance to the S-23. Gouge submitted the design in 1934. It had a deeper hull and longer nose section than the S-23, but included an armament of two machine guns, one mounted in the tail and another in the bows. By the time the prototype was complete, its armament had been increased to a nose turret with one 303 machine gun, two dorsal guns firing through open hatches in the sides of the fuselage, and a tail turret housing another four 303s. It was the first British aircraft to include a defensive armament of power-operated turrets. In March 1936, the Air Ministry placed an initial order for 21 aircraft, and 18 months later, on the 16th of October 1937, K-4774 made its maiden flight. After modifications to the wing layout, the prototype made further flights from the River Medway in the spring of the following year. Now bearing the name Sunderland, it was powered by four Bristol Pegasus 22 engines, rated at just over 1,000 horsepower each. Even while the prototype was undergoing flight testing, Shorts had already begun to construct the first batch of Mark I production machines. By May 1938, the first few aircraft were ready, and deliveries to the RAF began in June. First to receive the new boats were 230 Squadron based at Seletar, Singapore, and 210 Squadron at Pembroke Dock. Both squadrons adopted the Sunderlands as replacements for their existing biplane Singapores. The initial reaction of its crews was one of amazement. The sheer size of the cavernous hull was something they had never experienced before.
First flight in the Sunderland must have been at 228 Squadron in Pembroke Dock. I think at the time it was great excitement to be on a modern airplane, because the only ones I'd flown had been the biplanes up to then. And here was a monoplane, the very, very latest in aircraft technology. And of course, as I say, the largest operational aircraft in the world. And that time must have been very exciting for a 19-year-old to be doing that. And it was exciting. It was a great privilege, I think, to be captain of an aircraft like that. And because you've got entire responsibility for the crew and for the aircraft, and you go out into the mid-Atlantic, and there's only one person who will get you back again, and that's you. Because there are no radio aids, radio silence, complete silence, no automatic pilot, no radar. If the aircraft was going to get back again, you were the one who had to get it back. And so it was, call it exciting if you like, it was challenging. You navigated entirely by astro, because everything was mathematical. You had to work it out mathematically, you see, and so it was important to know how high you were. And if you were using the marine sextant and not the Air Force bubble sextant, you had to get down to about 20 feet. That means the place where the navigator was standing had to be 20 feet. You had about 10 feet of hull underneath you, so that put you fairly close to the waves. And you usually knew when you got down there, because the wireless operator would come and tap you on the shoulder and say, "I've lost my aerial again, sir." And of course you had a trailing aerial where you received messages. You weren't allowed to send any, you received messages from base. And of course, if you didn't warn the wireless operator that you were going down, to give him time to wind the aerial in, the first thing he knew that you were doing the slow flying was that he'd lost his aerial. And so this wasn't very, very popular. Otherwise, you navigated entirely by dead reckoning. Just looking out of the window and estimating the speed of the wind and the drift. And we carried, there was a theory that we carried two pigeons, so that if we came down the sea, the idea was you put a note in on the pigeon's leg and launch the pigeon. The pigeon would fly back and tell everybody you were down the sea. That was the official theory of it. Actually, we said that the real idea was that if you were lost, you took the pigeon out of the basket, stood it on the navigator's table on the chart, and drew a line between where you thought you were to your base. And if the pigeon nodded, you were all right.
Even when they were miles away from the nearest base, Sunderlands could remain self-sufficient for long periods of time. Although unladen, the Mark I weighed in at 12.5 tons. Fully loaded, it could weigh more than 20 tons. Later developments would increase the all-up weight by almost 7 tons. Even so, the Sunderland's performance was a vast improvement over its predecessors. With a maximum speed of 210 miles per hour, it was nearly 70 miles per hour faster than the Singapore Mark III. Service ceiling was just over 20,000 feet, and the four Pegasus engines provided a respectable climb rate of 1,200 feet per minute, almost twice as fast as the Singapore. Six main wing tanks and four small auxiliary tanks housed a total of 2,500 gallons of fuel, giving the boat an unprecedented range of almost 3,000 miles.
The Sunderland would normally have two guns in the front turret and four in the rear turret. Amidships, the Mark I had two guns midships, but they were just two holes in the top of the fuselage, really, and you took the cover off and just stood up in the slipstream with the guns on a scarf ring, which enabled you to point it in most directions. Then later on, that was changed into a two-gun midship turret. And then later on still, that was after I'd left the North Atlantic operations, there were 2.5s put in the nose. But that was in response to a change in the German submarine tactics. And in my day, if a submarine saw an aircraft coming, it would dive at once. And we had eight depth charges, 250 pounds each, filled with Torpex, which was the explosive at the time. And they were, if I can explain, the depth charges were set to go off at certain depths. Then you could change the depth from 10 feet, 20 feet, 50 feet, and so on. And if you were running in onto a submarine, you would press what was called the Mickey Mouse, which was the thing which set off the depth charges in the right order. So long as the submarine was diving, and so long as you were going in the same direction as the submarine, the theory was that the depth charges would go off with the submarine as it went down. Later on, the Admiral Dönitz, I think it was, instructed the submarines not to dive, but to stay on the surface and fire back at the aircraft attacking them. And of course, this wasn't terribly good news for the Sunderland, because with only two guns in the front and 303s, which don't have much punch in them really and didn't go very far, they got quite badly shot up. So they put 2.5s in the front, which had a longer range and also had more go in them. Then you went in and fired your 0.5s and hopefully hit the chaps in the submarine who were firing at you.
Offensively, the Sunderland was able to carry a load of 2,000 pounds, made up of bombs, depth charges, or mines. Two motorized tracks were mounted underneath the wings, and when the boat went into action, the weapons could be run out on sliding carriers through large opening hatches in the sides of the fuselage. Behind the engineer's compartment, the rear end of the upper deck carried a variety of smoke markers, reconnaissance flares, and flame markers. Further behind and below in the deep rear fuselage deck was stowed a mixture of other equipment, including distress flares, a reconnaissance camera, a dinghy, emergency rations, and even three spare propeller blades. At the rear end of the lower deck was a canvas doorway giving access to the fin and tailplane mountings and the rear gun turret. In the forward part of the hull below the flight deck was the bomb aimer's position, and behind it the dinghy and anchor stowage area. The nose turret above this area was rail mounted, so that when the boat was moored at sea, the whole turret could be winched back and the large anchor passed through the bow opening. Immediately under the flight deck were the toilet compartment, the connecting stairway, and the forward wardroom and sleeping area. By the outbreak of war in September 1939, some 40 Sunderlands had gone into service. 228 Squadron, based with 210 at Pembroke Dock, had begun to re-equip for the new boats some 10 months earlier. And by April 1939, it had eight Sunderlands on strength. 204 Squadron started to re-equip in June, and by the end of the following month, it too had received a complement of eight boats. In July, number 10 squadron of the Royal Australian Air Force arrived in the UK to collect its new machines and ended up staying there for the whole of the war. In doing so, it became the first Australian squadron to serve in Europe during the Second World War. As hostilities got underway, the Sunderlands began to perform the kind of operation for which they were ideally suited, the long and tiring maritime patrol. Very often, they would encounter nothing at all except endless miles of ocean. But on September the 18th, 1939, came one of their first successes. Torpedoed 70 miles off the Scillies by a German U-boat, all 34 crew members of the SS Kensington Court had taken to the lifeboats. They were rescued by two flying boats from 204 and 228 squadrons and were back in England within an hour of their ship being sunk. It was the first operation of its kind in the history of the RAF and resulted in the first DFCs awarded to any Sunderland aircrew.
I first saw action sort of with guns being fired in anger type action. Flying from Pembroke Dock down the Bay of Biscay, and we were down quite low down towards Spain, and we saw three U-boats, and they were on the surface. And they stayed up on the surface and brought their guns to bear on us. And then a Halifax from Coast Command appeared, and he was damaged by them. Then another Sunderland appeared, and we stayed out of range of their guns for a while, and we circled round until one of the U-boats in manoeuvring to try and keep us on their beam so they could bring all their guns to bear on us got separated from the other two, and Hank Hanbury, who was our skipper at the time, he was very experienced, he was an ex-Imperial Airways flying boat pilot, and he just said, here we go, we went in. And it was so low that we just jinked over the top of the conning tower, and we straddled put four depth charges on one quarter and the other four on the bow, and there was an almighty explosion, and then shortly after that there was oil all over the sea. And there were what seemed like hundreds of sailors bobbing in this oil, and you could actually smell the fuel oil. And for the first time, one felt sorry for the people. You could previously just thought of a U-boat, but now you actually saw bodies bobbing up and down. And one of the chaps said, let's drop my life boat, because we used to carry two. And so we did that, and we saw a few of them struck out for the boat and got on board it. And then we saw five JU-88s came in, and they had obviously been sent to cover these three U-boats crossing, and had arrived a bit late. And in a way, fortunately for us, they saw an RAF lifeboat on the sea and obviously thought that a Sunderland crew had been shot down, and that was what was in that lifeboat, so that we were able to sit away up in the clouds, and we got away. You know, it was lucky.
Although in the early days of war, the flying boats had little success against German submarines, a 228 Squadron Sunderland played a key role in the demise of one of the first U-boats sunk. On January the 30th, 1940, N9025 was on convoy escort duty southwest of the Scillies when its crew sighted U-55. Confronted by the Sunderland and under threat from two British warships, the sloop Foy and destroyer Whitshead, the U-boat commander chose to scuttle his boat rather than surrender. Although it was the first positive part played by Sunderland's in a U-boat kill, the flying boats began to face an increasingly difficult situation. When Hitler invaded Norway in April 1940, the length of coastal waters under German control was extended dramatically. With new bases from which to operate, the U-boats became an even greater threat to vital British supply convoys. Without, as yet, any proper detection equipment, the flying boats had no effective means of locating a submarine except by visual sighting. Even when they did manage to find one, the only anti-submarine weapons carried by the Sunderland were the RAF standard general-purpose high-explosive bombs. These were of little use against a U-boat hull, and the situation only improved when the bombs were replaced by an adaptation of the much more efficient naval depth charge.
Okay, sir.
But in spite of the early problems with anti-submarine weapons, the Sunderland's defensive armament was to prove highly effective. During a North Sea escort flight on the 3rd of April 1940, a 204 Squadron Sunderland was attacked by six Junkers Ju-88s. In the ensuing air battle, one of the German machines was shot down, a second was forced to land in Norway, and the other four were driven off.
We were attacked by six Ju-88s. And their method of attack was that three of them would form up on the quarter and three of them form up on the opposite bow. So if you tried to turn into the attack, you left the sitting target to the other three. It seemed like ages that they were attacking us. They never wounded anyone. And we reckoned that we shot one of them down, but whether we actually did is always hard to know. We saw smoke coming out of him, etc. And it was all dodging in and out of clouds, because in clear weather you would be shot down by 688s, no doubt about that. But if there's enough cloud, you could dodge in and out and he'd get a quick shot at you and you'd get a shot at him and so on. And that carried on for a while until we found enough cloud to escape and get back home.
A similar incident took place later in the war over the Bay of Biscay, when another boat was attacked by no less than eight Ju-88s. This time, it shot down three of the attackers and drove off the rest. These and numerous other clashes caused the Germans to treat the Sunderland with the greatest respect. They nicknamed it the Flying Porcupine. As the war at sea intensified, Shorts began to look for ways of improving the Sunderland. A number of modifications resulted in the production of several main variants. From August 1940, the ASV-1 search radar set was fitted to a number of Mark 1s. Although it increased the chances of locating a submarine, it proved to be an unreliable system and was not fitted as standard until the arrival of the much-improved ASV-2. With its array of aerial masts and transmitter loops, this new set was factory-fitted to the second Sunderland variant, the Mark II, which began to appear in 1941. With the aim of improving performance, the Mark II used twin-speed supercharged Pegasus 18 engines instead of the Pegasus 22s fitted to the Mark I. Further improvements in performance came with the introduction of the Mark III Sunderland. Fitted with a shallower front planing step to provide better handling characteristics, the first production Mark III took to the air for the first time in December 1941. In response to the ever-increasing need for better armament, some of the new boats were given additional firepower. The Mark III became the main wartime Sunderland variant, representing well over half of the 750 boats that were built in total. In spite of the limited introduction of a Mark IV variant with four 1,700 horsepower Bristol Hercules engines, the second most widely used Sunderland became the Mark V. Equipped with the latest ASV radar apparatus, it was a formidable opponent. Its Pratt & Whitney 1,200 horsepower twin Wasp engines were more reliable than the existing Pegasus power plants and gave the aircraft a greater range and a higher maximum speed. Fitted with fully feathering propellers, the American engines also enabled the Mark V to continue cruising even when both engines on one side were out of action. None of the earlier boats had been able to do this without losing height. Production of the Mark V began in 1944, and by the time the last Sunderland rolled off the factory lines in June 1946, a total of 150 had been built. They would remain as the RAF's standard flying boat until their eventual retirement in 1959.
The crews, the same as myself, thought that it was absolutely marvellous aircraft. We were all very thankful we got on operations in that flying boat. It was, to give you an example, on a 14-hour trip, we carried 11 crew as the skipper, second pilot, and more sometimes another pilot, navigator, engineer, wireless operator, and of course the three gun turrets had to be mounted. And we had to have reliefs for those people because on a 14-hour trip, just watching the sea all the time, well, your eyes got very tired, I tell you. And another interesting thing, we had two meals on board, which was rather good. We usually had bacon and egg and chips for one meal, and a steak and vegetables for another, which was done in the galley. The crew I had on 228 was absolutely wonderful. My second pilot, Anthony Neville Stack, was very, very good. Unfortunately, he died a little while ago. And unfortunately, my navigator, who was, I think, absolutely perfect, happened to be lost when Lee Mallory was flying out to Spain, and they crashed into a hill in the mountains of Spain. And in a normal day, we would be called in the morning and go to breakfast, and then we have the briefing, and after that you were tracked down to the water where we carried a dinghy out to the aircraft and entered through the front door, and then normally took off about first light, and more than not, we had to get got back on a flare path, which was just three boats with a little lamp on them. But fortunately, all you had to do was to put the aircraft down at 200 feet a minute and touch down on the first light, and it was quite simple. Take off, unless it's a very large swell, was not too bad. If you took off in a big swell, you couldn't get a straight run, you were just a wallow, so you had to cut your engines to start again. But lighting, if it's a flat calm, you had to do the same procedure as a night landing. You couldn't see what height you were above the water. You couldn't have any idea at all. The second pilot used to look out and hope for the but mainly, you lowered it at 200 feet a minute, and you just, the second pilot would tell you when you were actually down.
Oh, I think most of people flying Sunderlands during the war considered themselves to be extremely lucky, really, because it's very comfortable aircraft to fly in. It's long time, although the trips were quite long, you had breaks because the crew could cook your meal in the Sunderland, or if you had the luxury of two crews, one could take a nap while the other was doing the flying. So I would say that it was a very, very popular aircraft. I think they were very, very, very proud to be part of a Sunderland crew. And Coastal Command generally, I think, was so small compared with Bomber Command that it was very much welded together, really. The spirit in Coastal Command as a whole was very good. Sunderland was really a very reliable aircraft, really, and maintenance, if you get them out of the water, was fine, but all flying boats, one of the hazards of the flying boat was, in fact, getting them out of the water. And so if you could get them out of the water, your maintenance made much easier. And that's why at Pembroke Dock, when we had the floating dock, which was a ship with two ramps each side, and so you put the aircraft into the centre of it and then raise the whole thing up, you're working, as it were, with your feet in the dry. And we also had this mechanical dock which we could bring them ashore on. And this has always been a problem with me of getting boats so that you can work on them on the dry. And when I went out as the engineer officer to 10 Squadron to Arzu, which is a small fishing village in North Africa, we had this problem of maintenance. And by chance, they were building the harbour at Arzu, and there was a beautiful man there. I think he was an Italian, but he was operating the cranes, and he was picking up these huge boulders to build the breakwater. And I said to him one day, why don't you put those down more neatly? And he said, well, don't be so silly. We put them down all higgledy-piggledy because that breaks up the waves. And I said, how accurately can you handle your crane? Oh, he said, to an inch. Oh, I said, well, do you think if we arranged for you to pick up the flying boats, you could take them and put them on the dockside for us to do our maintenance? Oh, he said, yes, I certainly could do that. So I did a deal with him, and we arranged for him to pick up our flying boats during that Arzu trip and put them on dry. And that cut down our maintenance, and when you come to think, maintenance means motorboats, weather, clothing, tools, dropping them in the ocean, and all things that go with operating out of boats.
But in the war-torn Atlantic of the 1940s, Sunderlands were to bear the brunt of anti-submarine work until help arrived in the form of the very long-range American boat, the Consolidated Catalina.
Thank you.
squadrons continued their anti-submarine patrols and convoy escort duties, they built up a lasting reputation for carrying out daring rescue operations. Many men owed their lives to these mercy missions, both in mid-ocean and in coastal waters. During the German invasions of Norway, Greece, and Crete, the flying boats plucked countless Allied servicemen from the jaws of the advancing Axis troops. In the evacuation of Greece in April 1941, one of 228 Squadron Sunderland's evacuated a group of no less than 80 Army and Air Force personnel in a single trip. Together with the boat's own aircrew, the Sunderland managed to take off from the port of Kalamata with a total of 90 men on board. A few days later, German paratroops began the assault on Crete, and by the end of May, the Sunderlands were once again busy, this time flying evacuation sorties between the beleaguered island and the comparative safety of Egypt. At Taranto in 1940, their endeavors in carrying out a vital reconnaissance of the Italian fleet resulted in a victorious attack by the fleet air arm. Throughout the war, Sunderlands, especially those of 230 Squadron, saw service in almost every theater, including Europe, the Middle East, and the Far East. As a typical example of the boat's worldwide wartime activities, this squadron was continually moving from base to base. Among the places it flew from were Pembroke Dock, Seletar, Ceylon, Abukir, and Burma. In the war against Japan, 230 was involved in evacuating troops from Burma and shortly after began the first of many successful strikes on Japanese ships. After VJ Day, the squadron took part in the large-scale recovery of Allied troops from Japanese prisoner of war camps. When the war in Europe effectively ended in May 1945, the RAF took the precautionary measure of maintaining anti-submarine patrols for another month. Coastal Command's last U-boat patrol was flown by a Sunderland from 201 Squadron during the first week of June 1945. Although the figures were later revised, by the end of the war, Sunderland crews had claimed a total of 35 U-boats sunk and another 20 damaged, but the cost was high. The total number of Sunderlands lost throughout the war amounted to well over 200. In post-war years, Sunderlands continued to play a major part in RAF activities. During the Berlin airlift in the second half of 1948, they transported several thousand tons of vital air freight. Throughout the Korean War, Japanese-based Sunderlands of the Far East Flying Boat Wing made more than 1,500 sorties and flew nearly 14,000 hours. Between 1951 and 1954, boats from 201 and 230 squadrons provided the transport for men and equipment of the British North Greenland Expedition. By 1957, Britain's large land-based aircraft had on the whole become cheaper, faster, and more efficient to operate. As the Sunderland's career drew to a close, all of the home-based squadrons were disbanded, and the majority of their aircraft faced an undignified end when they were sold as scrap metal. At Seletar, the Far East boats of 205 and 209 Squadron were the only ones to remain in military service. Externally, in spite of its great bulk, the boat had an overwhelming air of solidity and elegance. The high-sided fuselage and large forward planing step, which ran aft along the bottom of the hull, only added to this distinguished appearance. Its solid design, large carrying capacity, and powerful defensive armament gave it an unrivaled ability to succeed in a wide variety of roles. Much loved by its crews and highly respected by its enemies, the Sunderland became a legendary campaigner. Of all the flying boats to serve with the RAF, it was the last and undoubtedly the finest.
I don't know what epitaph I would have for it. It was a good aircraft, Sunderland a good aircraft, comfortable aircraft. Everybody liked it. I'd never met anybody who didn't like it. But time overtook it. Soon as you got the jets in, the big jets in, then really it began to lose its raison d'etre. But of course the big jets demanded giant airfields, which of course we've built since then, and with it has come all the high technology, the radar and various things, which we didn't have at all in those days. But I think in its day, it was a very, very fine aircraft and did a good job extremely well.
I haven't met anyone who didn't like the Sunderland. It was just big and substantial, and that big main spar. And you used to take up landing positions with your back to the main spar, and you felt that you were up against a brick wall sort of thing. Quite different from flying, say, in a Lanka or a Wellington.
Well, it was very maneuverable. You could throw it about. With the size of it, you would think that, you know, you couldn't do very much with it. But you could throw it about. When we attacked, we had to weave a bit. And you could do that quite easily. It was a really marvelous aircraft.